So Phokion, we'll try to run this talk the same way as the last one, if you're okay with questions during the talk.
Please for monitor the chat, because it's difficult for me to multitask in this setting.
Exactly. Yes. If there's any questions come in, I think it's appropriate. I'll stop you with the questions.
Yeah, by all means.
And again, I encourage people, if they post questions to the chat window, please make it visible to participants, to panelists and attendees, so that everyone can see them. So I guess we're probably ready to start. So it's a great pleasure to introduce Phokion Kolaitis, who's at UC Santa Cruz and IBM Almaden Research Center. He's speaking today on strict NP, expressive power, structure, and complexity. So
thank you. Thank you very much, Sam. I'm very honored to be able to speak in this group, in this seminar series. And I should say that after receiving, or about the time I received the invitation from Sam to give the talk, I also received a strong encouragement from Albert to speak about strict NP. And so in some sense, the topic has been commissioned here. And I gladly accepted that, because I view this as an opportunity to tell you something about the centrality of logic in the theory of computing. So the context that we have here is that we use logic as a specification language. And this also goes under the name of definability theory, where logic is used as a language to define mathematical objects. And the main goal is to find and study the characteristic properties of definable objects. This is a quote from a book on descriptive set theory, where the objects are subsets of the real numbers. In our case, the objects are classes of finite structures. More precisely, we have a relational schema, or just schema, which is a finite set of relational symbols, each coming with a specified arity. And then is a tuple consisting of a universe and relations on that universe whose arities match those of the schema. And the finite structure is a structure whose universe is finite. So this is the context of finite model theory, if you will. And now the important definition is that if we have a class of finite structures and the logic, we say that the class is definable in the logic if there is a sentence of the logic, so that for every finite structure, we have that the structure belongs in the class of structures if and only if the structure satisfies the sentence. So this is precisely the notion of uniform definability that Albert was talking about a few weeks, a few Wednesdays ago in the other seminar series. We have a single sentence that acts as a specification, and it filters out and singles out precisely the structures that belong to the class. Now let's look at some logics by way of reminding you, again, we have a fixed schema, and then first order logic is obtained from the atomic formulas, which assert membership of a tuple in a relation, equality, and then the standard Boolean operations and quantifiers. But these are first order quantifiers, and this means that they range over elements of the universe of the structure. As a simple example, we can specify in first order logic that the graph has diameter at most 2 by saying that for every 2 nodes, there exists a third node, and either the 2 nodes are equal, or they are connected via an edge or via a path of bank 2 that goes through VZ. When we go to second order logic, we enhance the syntax with second order quantifiers, exist s and for all s, where now this range of the relations of fixed arities. Arguably the simplest fragment of, or one of the two simplest fragments of second order logic is existential second order logic, where all the second quantifiers are upfront and existential. So it is a formula of existential second order logic is of the form there exists one, there exists two, there exists m phi, where phi is first order. And now we come to the first fundamental connection between logic and computation in this context, which is Phokion's theorem from his thesis at Berkeley. And the theorem says that if you have a class of finite structures, then this class is in NP, if and only if it is definable in existential second order logic. And as you can see from here, this is one characterization of NP that does not mention machines and does not mention polynomial in the definition, unlike practically all other characterizations of NP. As an example to illustrate Phokion's theorem, let's take SAT and show how it is existentially second order definable. Of course, now we need to think of SAT as a class of finite structures. So every formula in conjunctive normal form can be encoded as a finite structure where the universe is the union of the set of variables and the set of clauses. And the schema has three relations. One is a unary relation that basically singles out the clauses. And then we have two binary relations, P and N. P means that it consists of all pairs, C and V, so that the variable V occurs positively in the clause C, and similarly, negative, N stands for negative occurrences. It means that if we have a pair CV in N, it means that the variable V occurs negatively in the clause. And with this now, we see that a satisfiability encoded as a finite structure A sub phi is expressible by this formula of existential second order logic that says there exists an S. So, and this is the set of variables that are set to true, so that for every clause there exists a variable, and if C is a clause, then if a variable occurs positively, then V is in S. If it occurs negatively, V is not in S. A very natural encoding of satisfiability in existential second order logic. Now I'm ready to define strict NP, which is the topic of this talk. And to motivate the definition, let me remind you that every existential second order formula has a normal form. It can be written as exists S, where S is a tuple of relation symbol variables, followed by for all X exist Y, where X and Y are tuples of first order variables. In other words, we can undo with the arbitrary alternations of quantifiers and get them down to just two for all that exist. And the proof is we scolemize and replace functions by their graphs, an elementary exercise. So this is a normal form for existential second order logic. Every formula can be written on this form. And now we are ready to give a definition of strict NP. Strict NP goes a step further and eliminates the existential variable. So we are looking now at formulas of existential second order logic of the form there exists for all X, where S is a tuple of relation symbol variables, X is a tuple of variables, and theta is quantifier free. So this is a very simple fragment. From the second order logic keeps the existential second order quantifiers. From the first order logic keeps just the universal quantifiers. Let's see what we can do and what we cannot do with this fragment. First of all, we have that three SAT is S and P definable. And for this, we need to encode three CNF formulas as finite structures. We're using a different encoding here. Each formula is encoded by a structure over a schema that has four relations of arity three. And these four relations stand for the four different types of clauses of length three. R0 are the clauses that have all variables appearing positively. R3, the ones that have all variables occurring negatively, and R1 and R2, we have one negative occurrence and two negative occurrences. So with this encoding then, we have this definition of three SAT in strict NP. We say that there exists an S. Again, S is the set of variables that we set to true. And for every triple, if it belongs to one of these four relations, then it must have the corresponding behavior that guarantees the satisfiability of the clause. For example, if it is in R3, this means the clause has only negative literals, then at least one of the UVW must be set to false. And of course, this extends to KSAT. We have to change the schema. We have to use K plus one relations, each of RDK. And then it's a little exercise to show that SAT is not strict NNP definable. Therefore, SNP is a proper fragment of existential second order logic. This uses basically preservation properties, model theoretic properties of SNP. Let's look at two more examples of SNP so that we get the sense of its expressive power. Free colorability is SNP definable. Here is the formula. It basically asserts there are three unary predicates. These are the color classes, the nodes that we color red, green, or blue. The first two lines say that the sets R, G, and B form a partition. And the last clause says that if we have an edge, then the endpoints of the edge must be in different parts of the partition. So that's a very natural encoding of free colorability in SNP, existential second order, followed by universal first order. And the last example to illustrate the expressive power of SNP, of course, it is generalized to K colorability. We just have more existential second order quantifiers. The last example is a problem taken from Gary and Johnson, a monochromatic triangle. The problem says, given a graph, is there a partition of the set of the edges of the graph so that neither part contains a triangle? And this is definable by this sentence that says there exists an S, but now S now is a binary relation symbol, and we stipulate symbol that's a subset of the edges. Whenever we have a triangle and two of the three edges are in S, the third one is not in S. So monochromatic triangle has this very natural encoding is in SNP. So this is the definition of SNP. And now I want to discuss what we're going to do with this.
Could I ask you a question?
Of course.
Yeah, so you said that SAT was not SNP definable.
Yes.
But you meant in that particular way of representing SAT. Are there other natural ways of representing SAT where it is SNP definable? And should you care about them?
In every schema, if you have SNP definability, you will have preservation under substructures of some sort. And that's not what SAT has. I meant here the particular schema, but I think the same thing would work for other schemas.
Okay. So that should hold for a wide range of natural ways of formulating SAT.
Yes. Okay. I have not thought if it's any imaginable category, but I think the same model theoretic argument will work.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. So SNP has many different facets, and I want to tell you about four of these facets. None of the results is new. The point of the talk is to give you a synthesis of all these results to show the centrality of SNP in these various areas. The first has to do with asymptotic probabilities and zero-one laws. The second with approximability of optimization problems. The third with constraint satisfaction. And the fourth with sub-exponential complexity, of which we had a great deal in this seminar. Let's talk about asymptotic probabilities. The setting is different than the one we had before in a very nice talk by Lenka. We have a class of all finite structures, and we have a property of some structures over that schema. We're focusing here on the uniform probability model, which is obtained by looking at the n-element structures in F, and we look at the of the n element structures in F that have the property P. So these are probabilities as relative frequencies. And this is mu n of P, the fraction of the n element structures in F that have the property. And then we have a sequence of values, of course, and we take the limit as n approaches infinity, provided the limit exists. A great deal is known about this measure. Let's first of all look at some examples. With probability one, all graphs are connected. With probability zero, the graphs are not are free colorable. So almost all graphs are not free colorable. A more challenging result that was actually a paper published in 1976 is that with probability one, all graphs are Hamiltonian. Almost all graphs are Hamiltonian. But be careful, it's not always the case that we have these nice values for the probabilities, because you can take a very simple property, such as even cardinality, which means there is an even elements in the universe, and this doesn't exist because mu and p oscillates between zero and one. If you come from logic and you look at these probabilities, you would like to ask yourself, is there an explanation for these probabilities? Can we make sense out of all these probabilities? And this brings us to the notion of a zero-one law. We say that the logic has the zero-one law, or the zero-one law holds for the logic, if for every property definable in the logic, we have that the asymptotic probability of the property exists and is either zero or one. And the first important result was obtained independently by Glebsky, Kogan, Lyogonyi, and Talanov in what at the time was the Soviet Union in 1969, and Phokion at Berkeley in 1972. And they proved with very different methods that the 0-1 law holds for first order logic. So all first order properties have asymptotic probability either 0 or 1. An important corollary of this is that even cardinality is not first order definable, because we saw a minute ago that it doesn't have asymptotic probability. Now, there are other proofs and easy proofs using Ehrenfoid-Frisee games that even cardinality is not first order definable. But the point is that the 0-1 law gives you massive inexpressibility results. Every property that does not have asymptotic probability 0 or 1 is automatically not definable in your logic. Once you have the 0-1 law, there is a natural algorithmic question, namely, if I give you a sentence in the logic, can I decide its probability? And there is a theorem by Etienne Granzin, which was actually his PhD thesis in 1985, that the decision problem for the probabilities of first order sentences is p-space complete. Let's pause for a moment and reflect, if you will, on the epistemological significance of this result. You can think of it as being a trade-off between truth and absolute truth. By absolute truth, I mean, look at the first order valid sentences, the sentences that are true on all finite structures in our case. This is an undecidable problem. Given a sentence, is it true on all finite graphs? That's Trachtenberg's theory. So discovering absolute truth is undecidable, but if you want to settle for less, for almost sure truth, it's decidable and actually p-space complete. The interesting thing about this result is that the lower bound is easy. It is inherited by Stockmeyer's p-space hardness of quantified Boolean formulas. The upper bound is the interesting result, and this was obtained by an effective elimination of quantifiers and using an alternating p-time algorithm. So this was the 0-1 for first order logic.
So quick question.
Of course.
So here, when you say probabilities of FO sentences, this is over all possible structures, right? This is not limited to finite structures.
It's finite structures. It's only finite because they remember the probabilities were defined as the fraction of the n-element structures that have the property, right?
Right. Thank you.
So this is all about finite structures. We are in the realm of finite model theory. Thank you for the question. So we have a 0-1 for first order logic. And if we go to existential second order logic, the 0-1 law fails, because very easily you can express even cardinality in existential second order logic. However, a long time ago, Moshe Vardi and I, in a paper in Stock 1987, saw that the 0-1 law holds for SNP. In fact, it holds for an extension of SNP called extended SNP, where you allow existential quantification first order after the existential second order and before the universal first order. So the 0-1 holds for SMP. The proof ingredients are three. Two of the three come from the proof of Phokion 0-1 law. Phokion found a set of axioms called the extension axioms that axiomatize almost sure truth, all the sentences that have probability one. And they have the property that they form an omega categorical theory, meaning that they have only one up to isomorphism, only one countable model, which is known as the random model. That's one tool. The second tool is the compactness theorem for first order logic. And the third is preservation properties, preservation under subtractions of some sort that I alluded before. So the three ingredients give you the 0-1 law. This was not so hard to obtain. What was more interesting was that the decision problem for the probabilities of SNP sentences is next time complete. So we're going here higher in complexity to next time complete. And the more interesting part was the upper bound, membership in next time. And this you brought into the picture the use of theorems from Ramsey theory, generalizations of the classical Ramsey theorem. They are there waiting for us to be used. They are obtained by Abramson and Harrington and by Nesetril and Rodel independently in the late 70s, early 80s. And roughly speaking, what this theorem gave us was this key lemma that if you have an SNP sentence psi, then this sentence has probability one if and only if you can find an exponentially large family of canonical structures. I'm not going to define what they are, structures with regularity properties, such that each member in the family satisfies the sentence. So the second condition is checkable in next time because you guess this family, you verify that it's canonical and it satisfies the sentence. Ramsey theory has been described as the pursuit of regularity amid disorder. And in some sense, this is the right tool to use here to get this lemma and from that lemma to get the upper bound. So in summary, we have seen that the 0-1 law extends to SNP, and we have a decision procedure for the deciding the values of the probabilities of SNP sentences. This is the first interaction of SNP with other areas. Now I want to change completely the context and go to approximation algorithms. Let me remind you that David Johnson in 1974, almost 50 years ago, wrote a very influential paper on approximation algorithms for combinatorial problems. This is the first paper that looked at such algorithms. And for example, he saw that maxsat is constant approximable, means set cover is log approximable. He set the landscape for the study of approximability of NP-hard optimization problems. At the end of his paper, there is a paragraph with concluding remarks and directions for further research, and there is a rather remarkable set of questions. I have taken here just a couple. Where do other optimization problems fit into the scheme of things? He concentrated in a bunch of problems. He knew of other problems, where do they fit? The second question is perhaps the most striking. Is there some stronger kind of reducibility than the simple polynomial reducibility that will explain these results? Or are they due to some structural similarity between the problems as we define them? I have highlighted and colored in blue the last phrase, are they due to some structural similarity between the problems as we define them, because this was a rather prophetic question, if you will. In effect, David Johnson, who was not a logician, unfortunately he has passed away, asked for, does logic play a role in approximability? And this question was hanging out there until about 15 years later, Papadimitriou and Giannakakis had a paper in Stock 1988, 1991 is the date of the journal publication, in which they used SNP to define a class of optimization problems. Here is the key idea. Start with an SNP formula. Exist S, for all x theta. And suppose that you know that there is no s that makes the remaining true. There is no s witnessing that there exists an s for all x theta xs. When you look at this as a Hessian problem, you're all done. The answer is no. But is there something you can do in this case? So the idea they had is, yes, you can do. Instead of looking for all x's, look for as many x's as possible. In other words, replace for all by max. Now we're looking for s's such that theta xs holds for as many x as possible. And voila, we have now defined an optimization problem. The problem is the max over all s's of the cardinality of the set of x's such that theta xs holds. We're looking for the maximum number of tuples that make theta true as we go over all s's. And this is precisely the definition of a class that turned out to be extremely influential. Their paper has over 2,000 citations. The class max SNP. So max SNP is the class of all maximization problems for which there is a quantifier-free formula such that for every finite structure, we have that the optimum of the problem over the structure is the maximum as we go over of S's of the number of X's that make the formula theta true. So optimization problems define using quantifier-free formulas. But clearly, as you see, the definition is motivated from strict NP. Let's look at some problems that are there. It won't come to you as a big surprise that max 3-sat is in max SNP, because we just saw that 3-sat is in SNP with encoding over schemas with four ternary relations. And indeed, max 3-sat, you take the definition of 3-sat in SNP, you strip the universal quantifiers and you count for how many triples people satisfy this formula, you go over all S's and that's max 3-sat. So that's an example of an optimization problem in the class max SNP. It easily extends to max K-sat and max not equal K-sat and all these other variants you can place in max SNP. Here is a problem of slightly different flavor, max cut, very important problem from optimization in graph theory. We're given a graph X, graph Z, excuse me. We want to partition the nodes into two sets, S and S complement, so that we maximize the number of edges between S and S complement. Max cut is in SNP. You just write down the definition and it's expressible using a quantifier-free formula. We go over.
Okay.
Number of pairs that form different sites. So max cut is also expressible in SNP. So we have seen how, I should say here, max cut is in max SNP, not SNP. So we have seen how SNP has motivated max SNP, and we have seen optimization problems in max SNP. What are the properties of max SNP? Let me remind you again of David Johnson's second question. Is there some stronger kind of reducibility than the simple polynomial reducibility that will explain these results, or are they due to some structural similarity between the problems as we define them? And the answer to both these questions is yes and yes. So in their paper, Papadimitriou and Giannakakis had two main results. The first was that every problem in max SNP is constant approximate. So here logic, and in particular this fragment motivated from SNP, gives us a unifying explanation for the approximability of a whole bunch of problems. As long as you write them this way, as long as you can express them in this fragment, they are automatically constant approximate. And the approximation algorithm is the naive greedy algorithm. And furthermore, max SNP contains problems that are complete via approximation preserving reduction. So this is the finer and stronger notion of reducibility, because of course the polynomial reducibility can destroy approximability. Not cover, me not cover and max out have very different approximation properties, yet there is a polynomial time reduction from one to the other. So this finer notion of reduction called L reductions, and L stands for linear, is precisely what allows you to preserve approximability. And what problems did they solve? They have a long list of problems in their paper. I here have taken just five. Actually, one is a family. Max k sat for every k bigger or equal than 3 is max S&P complete. So max 3 sat in particular is max S&P complete. Every problem is reducible to it via an approximation preserving reduction. Then they had a problem which is a special case of max 3 sat. Is max 3 sat B, where it is defined to be the restriction of max 3 sat where every variable occurs at most 3 times. This became the stepping stone to prove that other problems are complete, such as max independent set B. This is graphs in which the degree is bounded by some constant B, where B is bigger or equal than 3. Max 2 sat and max cut that we saw before. And interestingly enough, they had to do some combinatorics again here. The combinatorics was to use expanded graphs to prove part 2, that max 3 sat B is complete for max S&P, and then the proofs of the other parts use the second part in which expanded graphs were used. Once they had this result, they knew at the time, this is 1991, this is before the PCB theorem, that either every problem in max S&P would have a pitas, or no complete problem will have a pitas. Now, of course, we have the PCP theorem, so post-PCP theorem, we know that unless P equals NP, no max S&P complete problem has a pitas. So this is the second area in which S&P has played a role, and as you see, a very striking role. Now I'm gonna move to the third area, and the third area is constraint satisfaction, and then we'll have a very short discussion of I've seen several nice talks on constraint satisfaction here, including one 2 weeks ago by Andrei Krohin. The standard definition of constraint satisfaction was that an instance of constraint satisfaction is a triple, where you have a set of variables, domain for the values of the variables, and a set of constraints, which are pairs of tuples of variables and carry relations over the domain. And the solution is an assignment of values to the variables so that the constraints are satisfied. This is the standard definition. That's what you find in any book on AI on constraint satisfaction. But for our purposes here, which was also the topic of Andrei Krohin's presentation 2 weeks ago, is that we can think of the constraint satisfaction problem as the homomorphism problem. This was put forward by Feder and Vardy. The original paper was in Stock 1993. 1998 is the date of the journal publication. They argued that CSP is the homomorphism problem, or more precisely, can be identified with the homomorphism problem. The homomorphism problem is not a single problem. It's a family of problems, one for every structure B over some fixed schema. So if you have a structure B, and again, here, finite structures, CSPB is the following decision problem. I give you a structure A, is there a homomorphism from A to B? This is a very broad paradigm of algorithmic problems. For example, K colorability is CSP, where B is the complete graph with K nodes, K, and this is true for every K bigger or equal than 2. And at that time, 1993 in Stock, 1998 in the general version, Feder and Vardy put forward the conjecture that for every structure B, we have a dichotomy. Either CSP B is in P or it is NP complete. So there is no B, so that CSP B is a problem of intermediate complexity, And we know through Leibniz theorem that such problems exist, assuming, of course, P is different from NP. We know the outcome of this conjecture, and I'll return to it later, but let me go on for now, just the way things were in 1998. What else did Feder and Vardy did doing that paper? Well, they brought into the picture a fragment of SNP, which they called monotone monadic SNP. This was mentioned several times in Andre's talk 2 weeks ago, but he stayed away from defining. I want to define it and talk about it because that's the point of this talk. Monotone monadic SNP is the fragment of SNP consisting of all SNP formulas. So they are of the form existence one, existence n, second order, followed by for all x, with three restrictions. The first restriction is a restriction on second order variables. Namely, they are monadic, they are unary predicates. And the second and third condition are what give the name monotonicity to the class. The second condition says that every occurrence of each Rj, Rj's are the symbols in the underlying schema, is within an odd number of negation symbols. If this confuses you, it means that if you push in theta all the negations inside to atomic predicates, then all occurrences of Rj are negated. And also, there are no equalities or inequalities that occur in theta. So 2 and 3 make the monotonistic condition. 1 is a condition on the monadic. That's why it's called monotone monadic SNP, MMSNP. 3SAT that we saw before is in MMSNP because here it is. We have one unary predicate, existence, and the occurrences of the arrays are 0, are 1, are 2, are 3, are negated. If you write the disjunction, if you write the implication as a disjunction, you have not R0, you have not R1, you have not R2, you have not R3, and there is no equality. So this is an example of a sentence in MMSNP. Now, Feder and Vardy pointed out that CSP is a proper fragment of MMSNP. So this entails two things. First, containment, that every constraint satisfaction problem can be expressed in MMSNP. We saw one before, namely 3SAT. And also that the containment is proper. The first one is quite straightforward. You basically use one monadic symbol for every element of the universe of B. If you recall the colorability exam, we had the three color classes, and colorability is homomorphism to the triangle, CSP for the triangle. So that's exactly what's going on. You use one monadic symbol for each element of the universe of the structure. The strict containment actually holds even for universal first order sentences that are monotone. Consider the statement, the graph has no triangle. There is no triangle. The graph is triangle free. They argued, and it's a nice counting but simple argument, that triangle free is not a CSP B, because if you had such a B, so that triangle freeness amounts to homomorphism than B, this B would have to be bigger and bigger and bigger, so a B would have to be infinite. So there is no finite B that allows you to express triangle freeness. Okay, so CSP is properly contained in MMSNP, so why bother with MMSNP? Well, because Feder and Vardy prove that CSP and MMSNP are equivalent via randomized p-time reductions. Obviously, CSP is contained in MMSNP, as we just started with. It's the average direction we're talking about, how you go from MMSNP to CSP. And there, with the randomized reduction in one direction, they can do some combinatorics. And the combinatorics was constructions of structures with large gap. And these were probabilistic large gap constructions. So some combinatorics again enters the picture. These randomized reductions were de-randomized in a nice paper by Gabor Kuhn in 2013. He had to use more sophisticated combinatorics. He generalized the notion of expander graphs to expander relations. And he also he had to use a version of direct product called twisted product, which generalizes the zigzag product that Rheingold used in his celebrated result. So again, some interesting combinatorics come into the picture. So at this point, we have that CSP and MMSNP are polynomially time equivalent, which means that as regards dichotomy theorems, we have a dichotomy theorem for CSP if and only if we have a dichotomy theorem for MMSNP. Of course, now we know that this is true. We've heard before that many times actually in this seminar that Bulatov and Zhuk in 2017 independently showed that for every structure B, either CSPB is in P or CSPB is NP complete. And that, of course, by the work of Edervardi, means that we have the same dichotomy for MMSNP. So the question now that arises is, can we go further? What is the limit of the dichotomy theorems within this logic? And the answer is we can't go any further. This is really the limit. This is the top of the line. Because Federvardi in 1998 proved that every syndactic fragment of SNP that is larger than MMSNP contains problems that are neither in P nor NP complete. Every fragment larger than MMSNP contains Ladner type problems, problems of intermediate complexity. Now, I have to qualify this statement. It is not literally through every syndactic fragment, but rather every natural syndactic fragment, because you can always throw another sentence to a fragment. Let's look at the MMSNP again. It is strict NP with three restrictions: monadicity of second order quantifiers, every occurrence of the atoms from the vocabulary is negated. After we push the negation inside, no equality or inequality. So the precise statement is that if you drop one of the three conditions and keep the remaining two, then the corresponding fragment contains problems of intermediate complexity. So this is really three theorems. One for every three choose two combinations of these three properties. So in some sense, the quest for syntactic fragments from this point of view is done. The biggest fragment was MMSNP because it's the same as CSP. So this was the third interaction of SNP with some other area of in the theory of computing. And now I can say a few words about the last fragment, the last topic, which is sub-exponential complexity. We have heard a great deal about sub-exponential complexity. It was in the bootcamp in the live tutorial by Valentin Kabanets. Then we heard in the first seminar of this series a nice talk by Russell Impagliaccio. And then we had another nice talk by Ryan Williams. They all touched on this topic. But they didn't mention SNP, so I want to bring in SNP here. So which problems have sub-exponential complexity? The formal setting is a little delicate. With every decision problem, we associate a parameter. And typically, the parameter is the size of the solution on an input x to the problem. So in the case of three sides, for instance, the solution size is the number of variables. And the exponential time hypothesis of Impagliaccio and Paturi from 2001 says that three sides is not solvable in time two to the little o of n, where n is the number of variables. So this is, we have seen this before. In the 2001 paper by Impagliaccio, Paturi, and Zane, they introduced a class of reductions between problems with parameters, which they called self reductions. It stands for sub-exponential reduction family. And these are analogous to the L reductions that Papadimitriou and Yannakakis introduced. There they preserved approximability. Here these reductions preserve sub-exponential complexity. So if Q with parameter Q has sub-exponential algorithm and P with parameter P is self-reducible to Q with parameter Q, then P with parameter P has also a sub-exponential algorithm. And furthermore, they have a nice property that they compose. What did they prove in that paper? They proved that KSAT, with its natural parameter, the number of variables, is SNP complete via self-reductions. So SNP now comes into the picture again as a class of problems that has complete problems via these reductions that preserve sub-exponential complexity. And K-colorability with parameter n, the number of nodes, is also SNP complete via self-reductions. We heard a great deal about K sat n being complete. But I want to explain how 3 sat n is SNP complete via self-reductions. There are 3 steps in this reduction. Technically, the most challenging one is the second step. SNP comes in the first step. It says, so the theorem says that 3 sat with parameter n, the number of variables, is SNP complete via self-reductions. And step one says, fix some SNP formula psi. It has a natural parameter, which is the size of the solution, which is the size of the witnesses to the existential quantifiers. That's a natural parameter. Let's call it P. The formula is fixed, so it has a fixed number of occurrences of symbols from S. So K is the number of occurrences of symbols from S in theta. Then Psi, with its natural parameter, is self-reducible to K sat with its natural parameter. This is essentially grounding, something we do in passing from, for instance, in Helbrand's theorem, passing to propositional logic from first order logic. That's what it is here. But the point is, it also, you can do it in a way you preserve some exponential complexity. The second step is the challenging one, that K sat with a number of variables parameter is self-reducible to K sat with a number of clauses. And then step three is that K sat with a number of clauses reduces to set to 3 sat with a number of clauses, which clearly reduces to 3 sat with a number of variables. So in the second step of this, they had to use the sparsification lemma, which involves interesting combinatorics such as weak sunflowers. And the sparsification lemma has been discussed here many times. I won't state it precisely. Roughly speaking, it says that every KCNF formula is equivalent to a disjunction of sub-exponentially many KCNF sparse formulas, sparse meaning the number of clauses is a constant times the number of variables. And furthermore, these sparse formulas can be constructed in sub-exponential time. So the bottom line of all this is that SNP shows again here, and we can talk about problems that are complete for SNP via self-reductions. And at this point of time, we don't know what way the exponential time hypothesis will go, but unless ETH fails, no SNP complete problem is solvable in sub-exponential time. So these are the 4 areas. I'm at the end of the talk. Let me leave you with this summary, with this synopsis, if you will. We have made SNP the center of the universe in this past hour, and we have seen that SNP interacts with various areas, 0-1 laws for SNP, approximability algorithms, approximation algorithms for NP-hard optimization problems. From SNP, Papadimitriou and Giannakakis extracted SNP. SNP interacts with constraint satisfaction. Feder and Vardy extracted MMSNP. And in Pagliaccio, Zane, and Paturi, related the exponential time hypothesis to SNP. In each of these areas, different tools from combinatorics had to be used, Ramsey theory, expanded graphs, expanded relations, twisted products, and sparsification. So in some sense, I think this work that has taken place over all these years manifests one more time the unity of logic and computation. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for that talk. That was excellent. Applaud for everybody's behalf, and encourage everyone to think of questions to either put in the chat window or to speak up and ask. We already have one question in the chat window. So Thomas.
I think this question is already answered. I was too early. I ask you, Phokion, for your in your interesting talk, whether the intermediate NP intermediate problems are not in SNP, and think they are not. You already answered it later.
Intermediate problems are not in MMSNP. Are not in MMSNP, but they are in SNP. If P is different from NP, they are in SNP. There are problems in SNP which are intermediate. These are the theorems of Eder and Vardy, the last result that I mentioned there. Right. Every syntactic fragment of SNP.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if we take monadic SNP, but we drop, let's say condition two or condition three, then there are problems there.
I see.
Yeah. So MMSNP has no intermediate problems, because the dichotomy for MMSNP is the same as the dichotomy for CSP. So since CSP has no intermediate problems, MMSNP has no intermediate problems. But when you go higher, yes, there are intermediate problems. That's why this dichotomy theorem is the top of the line, so to speak, if you come from the viewpoint of SNP.
I see. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, of course.
Hi, Phokion. Thank you for a wonderful talk.
Thank you.
I had a rather, perhaps you covered this already. It's a naive question here. So we can characterize polynomial, the class P, with deterministic polynomial time algorithms, right? So every problem in P can be solved using a deterministic polynomial time algorithm.
Yes.
Every problem in P can be solved using a non-deterministic polynomial time algorithm. Is there a similar characterization for SNP, or is it only a logical characterization that you gave at the beginning?
Yeah, it's a very good question. Thank you. It is not that I know of. Part of the problem is that SNP is not closed under even first order actions. You see, you have it's not closed under polynomial time. It's not closed under polynomial time reductions. It contains NP complete problems, right? So every problem is reducible to it. Hamiltonicity is reducible to three colorability, but Hamiltonicity is not in SNP.
Okay, thank you.
So I don't know. I don't know how to make this. Make it precise or answer him better. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Of course.
So is there what I would call a quantifier exchange property for SNP, in the sense of say you put an existential, put a universal first order quantifier in front of an SNP formula. Is it still an SNP formula?
No. This gives you more, as far as I know. In fact, this class, universal first order followed by extensive second order, expresses some interesting problems. We call them robust and satisfaction. There is a paper by Samson Abramsky, Georg Gottlob, and myself in ITSCHI 2013, where Abramsky has been studying the foundations of quantum mechanics. And he has been developed a logical theory for the foundations of quantum mechanics, and in particular the theory of hidden variables. So there was a complexity question about these hidden variables, and we answered that in SNP hard by looking at an extension of constraint satisfaction where you have essentially universal quantifiers in front of this, and they are not equivalent. This is a different class. It deserves further study. We don't have more results other than this use in the study of robust constraint satisfaction.
So is it known that whether or not it satisfies the 0-1 laws, for instance?
No, it shouldn't satisfy the 0-1 law. I don't think that should satisfy the 0-1 law, because the zero, we know a great deal about the 0-1 laws for the fragments of existential second order. If you look at the existential second order, the fragments are basically the one I showed you, the extended SMP, and the Ackermann, the sigma 1-1 Ackermann. You have existential second order followed for all x, one universal exist y, one existential. That's the Ackermann class. I mean, you can have more existential, but just one universal. That has the 0-1 law. All the other bigger classes in the first order part, the 0-1 law fails. So my guess is it will also fail if I put something on the front. There is a version of what you asked, Sam, that had been studied by, Stockmeyer, Phokion, and Vardy. Phokion, Stockmeyer, Vardy as extended monadic NP. And they had properties. They had a game for that and so on.
So, Phokion, just...
Hi, Andrew.
Hey. No, just on this point. So if I understood right, you're saying that you can't put a universal quantifier outside an MMSNP formula because an SNP formula, surely it makes no difference because you can scolemize and push the universal inside by increasing the arity of the second order.
But then I would have good for all that exists.
No, I mean, increase the arity of the second order quantifiers.
Yes, but I have a function, right? So I would have to say for all that exist. I would have to have an existential after the for all, unless I'm missing something.
But you are allowed for all after the existential.
I think there's the difference between the extended SNP and SNP.
I see.
So if you have extended SNP, then you have this for all exist, as you're saying, Phokion.
Yes.
But what Anuj is saying is if you put for all in front of an SNP sentence, then it's okay.
I see. Yes. You are right. Yes. If in the extended, it takes you way out of all this. Yes. Yeah. Thank you, Andres. You are right. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, Albert.
Okay. Good. Thank you. Still have time for more questions. If anyone has any, feel free to post or say something. Or general comments.
Is there a paper, a survey paper on SNP that you would recommend?
Thank you for asking this question. One of Albert's motivations for that I give this talk is that we write such a paper.
So now you have to.
In some sense, you are confirming that it's not a bad idea. I think, and so I thank you.
You should write.
We didn't arrange the question, I have to say.
I won't tell them about the bottle of whiskey that you're planning to send to me.
Okay. We will. If we write, we'll send you a bottle.
All right.
Single malt, right?
Yes, of course.
Of course. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions? All right, I guess that's the end of this session. So thank you again, Phokion, for a really, really great talk. Covered a lot of very nice things.
Thank you.
It's great to see all this. So that's it for today. Thank you very much. And
thank you. Okay, bye.
Bye-bye.